Senator, I just want to be sure you don't want any seats reserved.
I must be losing my ability to be understood.
Sir?
Well, you asked me which seats I wanted reserved, and I said none. And now you ask me.
But there will be distinguished guests.
Indeed, there will be. There will be 2,400 distinguished guests. Distinguished not only for their courage, an open-mindedness, a willingness to listen, but no one more distinguished than the other. There will be no reserved seats. First come, first served.
Well, you want a seat for yourself, at least on the stage, for the chairman, whoever introduces you?
So far, everyone I've offered that honor to has a bad cold or previous commitment.
The Republican National Committee man.
Has bronchitis and is making a speech in Omaha.
But someone.
Well, I thought of doing it myself. False mustache, wig. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the honor to present a man greatly admired by all of you. Until this month, the junior senator from Nebraska. Well, now, that wouldn't fool anyone, huh?
You're going to speak without an introduction.
Well, I think they'll recognize me. The meeting will begin at 8. There will be no reserved seats. Good to see you. How have you been, huh?
How have I been? Worried. I started to worry when you started the filibuster.
Oh, now.
Extended debate, then, if you prefer. I worried worse when you wrote that silly letter to the governor. But I'm sick with worry at the thought of you going into the hall tonight to face that mob.
Oh, you think I'll draw a good crowd, huh?
Of course. George, I'm concerned.
Well, if just the people who are concerned for my safety show up, it'll be a good crowd. Come in.
Senator, I'm here from the Journal.
Let's see now, the Journal. It's hard to keep track of what the papers are saying. Does your paper call me a traitor or a political tramp or a moral pervert? You come here to interview a German agent?
No, just a United States senator. I'd like to know what this is all about.
If I tell you, will your editor print it?
The editor's out of the office. When he gets back, the paper will be out.
George, you've got to forget this whole crazy notion. People are in no mood to listen to reason. Not from you or anyone else.
Well, I sometimes think that the less people are in a mood to listen, the more important it is to talk.
No, not now. Your term has 2 more years to run. This whole thing will blow over. People forget.
They may forget, but I'll remember.
That they thought you were wrong?
That they thought I was a traitor. Well, even a traitor is entitled to a trial, and I mean to have mine now.
Don't you want to stay in the Senate?
Yes, I do, but there are more important things. You get a pencil, young man, and I'll tell you what this is all about.
That was George W. Norris, United States Senator in 1917, on the eve of World War I, and on the eve of a great personal decision. Here is George W. Norris of Nebraska in 1902. The beginning of a round trip that would take him to Washington and back over a period of 15 years.
The case of the state against Paul Powell, charged with horse stealing, let the record show that the defendant is in court. Gentlemen of the jury, have you reached a verdict?
We have, Your Honor.
The defendant will rise and face a jury. State your verdict.
We find the defendant not guilty.
What? We'll take our noon recess at this time. We'll record the verdict and discharge the defendant after lunch. I want the citizens to have an opportunity to go home and lock their stable doors. As for the jury, I'm going to be kinder to them than they've been to themselves by dismissing them without thanks at this time so that they can take the same precautions. Court's adjourned till 2 p.m. The answer is no.
I haven't asked you anything yet.
You don't have to. You're looking for a Republican to run for Congress, a man who's not tied in with the railroad, a man who has something of a local following. Huh?
And a man who cares. George, you care. And the people around here know it. They've seen you give extra time on foreclosures when crops fail in the drought.
Well, I don't think that an honest, hard-working man ought to lose his farm just because the Almighty hasn't provided enough rain, at least not right away.
That's what I mean. Now, Schellenberger will have plenty of leaflets and posters and bands and fireworks. You'll have what you and I can pay for out of our own pockets, and you know what that is.
Huh. You do take me for a fool, Sam.
I'm pretty sure of it. The kind of a fool that tries the impossible just because it ought to be done. Now, lately, we've suffered a shortage of them in this country, but we're not fresh out of them, are we?
A judge.
Well, I'm not going to have to do it anymore.
You going to hire someone to do it for you?
No, I've only got one poster left.
Can't you get more?
Not without paying.
Maybe on credit.
Politics is a lot like farming, Mrs. Andrews. You can only get credit when you can prove you don't need it. How am I doing up your way?
Oh, fine, Judge. Everybody that knows you's for you. Only not enough people know you. If we had something we could pass out, flyers, leaflets, anything.
Well, why don't you come over to my headquarters later and maybe we can find a pamphlet.
Don't you know?
Well, we mailed out the last 100 last week and Sam Ennis went down to the post office to see if any of it had been returned. If any came back, you might as well have it.
Oh, Judge.
Here you are, Mrs. Andrews. I just did happen to find a few pamphlets upstairs.
Every little bit helps. Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
You ever hear of Joseph Babcock? Well, he's a congressman from Wisconsin. He's also chairman of the Republican Congressional Campaign Committee.
I didn't know.
Yes, well, he sent you some mail. Now, take a look at this first. It's a check for $1,000 payable to the Norris for Congress Committee.
Let me see that.
And there are sacks of these down at the post office, containing copies of the congressional record, reporting a speech by the Honorable Mr. Babcock, singing the praises of George W. Norris, and commending your candidacy to the voters of this district. And Congressman Babcock has franked each and every one of these envelopes with his personal signature. The first thing you'll have to do is look him up.
Congressman George W. Norris from the state of Nebraska, number 16.
Fingal's cave. You think this is bad? Wait till you see your office. You looking for anybody special?
Mr. Babcock of Wisconsin.
Who?
He made a speech about me in the last session. Did I say something funny?
Excuse me. Did he say that you were fearless, capable, qualified? That the people of your district were indeed fortunate.
You heard the speech, huh?
No. Nobody heard it. It was never given. Just printed in the record. Complete with the word laughter when he makes a joke and applause when he gets to the end.
And you knew what he said?
I know what he never said. Because he never says the same speech about every Republican candidate who needs help. He sends them out by the carload. In franked envelopes, ready to go. There's the speaker. Here we go.
The House is in session, and the gentleman from North Carolina is recognized.
Mr. Speaker, I move that we do now adjourn until tomorrow at 10 o'clock in the forenoon.
On the motion, as many as are in favor, many as are opposed, and the House stands adjourned.
Why?
Why the adjournment? It's because Uncle Joe had no business he wanted to transact. That's Uncle Joe Cannon, the Speaker. He runs a tight ship.
Well, then why have a session at all?
Oh, just in case he wanted us to do anything.
In case he what? The people of our district sent us here just as those of his sent him. Now, why can we only consider such legislation as he wishes to consider?
He appoints the committees.
But for my own committee on buildings and grounds, if I may use a term to describe a body of men who barely know I'm alive, why must we have his consent before we can even write a bill?
Oh, your committee can write a bill, but it would never come to a vote. The Rules Committee determines the order in which bills come to the floor.
Oh, then that committee...
Uncle Joe's very careful who's on that committee.
But a bill taking the power of appointing the Rules Committee away from the Speaker.
Such a bill, like all bills, goes to the Rules Committee. They could bring it up this year, next year, sometime, or never. I'll leave it to you to guess.
Well, that power was given to the Speaker by the House, and it can be taken away by the House.
Well, maybe the House would be willing to do that. If the House ever had the chance to vote on such a proposition.
House is in session, and the gentleman from Indiana is recognized for 2 minutes.
Mr. Speaker, I direct the attention of the House to the fact that tomorrow will mark the 55th anniversary of the birth of the gentleman from California. I deliver in extending felicitations to this gentleman and in expressing the hope that he may long continue to observe his birthdays here in this house, where he has served so long and so devotedly. I now desire to wish him a happy birthday, and I beg leave to extend my remarks.
And this matter must be brought to a vote without coming before the Rules Committee.
How?
Well, I'll think of a way.
It's not going to be easy.
I didn't say it would be easy. Fourth term in the House. As some of you have been here longer, I think we all came here under the misapprehension that this was a legislature in which individual views were to be respected and not a battalion in which commands were to be obeyed. Now, the question is, are we prepared to do what is necessary to restore control of the House to its members? Mr. Gardner?
Of course.
Mr. Cooper? Mr. Nelson? Mr. Groner?
I'm with you.
Mr. Lindbergh? Charles?
How? We have no power in either party's caucus, and Joe Cannon will...
I don't think the key to the problem is in the caucus or in Speaker Cannon.
He has too much power. It's as simple as that.
Exactly. The Speaker has too much power, whether the Speaker is Joe Cannon or any one of us. The Speaker should be the servant of the House, not its master.
But when he alone appoints all the committees, especially the Rules Committee?
And that's the power he shouldn't have. Now, suppose we force him to let the House vote.
We can't do it.
Suppose.
No. Right or wrong, Joe Cannon would win. There are too many congressmen who are afraid to do anything against him.
Is it worth a try?
I don't think it'll work.
Is it worth a try?
Well, anything's worth a try.
I have a resolution here. I'm not going to read it to you, because I don't want any of you to have to share the responsibility. But when the time is right, I'll introduce it. It probably won't happen soon, maybe not even this session. But that's when we'll knock Mr. Cannon off his horse.
That's when we'll try.
That's when we try.
Mr. Speaker, I move to consider at this time a bill to provide for the taking of a census.
Point of order, Mr. Speaker.
Gentlemen will state it.
This subject is not on the calendar, and only matters pertaining to the calendar day may be heard.
Mr. Speaker, the Constitution requires that the census be taken every 10 years. It is necessary to treat this bill out of turn in order to meet that requirement.
The gentleman is correct. The resolution is in order at this time or at any time because it is made privileged by the Constitution. Is there a debate on the resolution that provides for the taking of the census?
Are you ready to vote?
Vote, 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 vote.
As many as are in favor,
many as are opposed, and the resolution is passed.
Mr. Speaker,
gentlemen from Nebraska.
Now, I present a resolution made privileged by the Constitution.
If it is indeed so privileged, the gentleman will state it.
Resolved that the rule authorizing the Speaker to appoint the Committee on Rules be repealed and the following substituted. That the Committee on Rules shall be named by the members of the House, 8 by the majority party, 7 by the minority party. That the Committee shall select its own chairman. That the Speaker shall not be a member of the Committee on Rules.
I'm going to stop this nonsense.
Point of order. The resolution's out of order.
Mr. Speaker, you have just held that a resolution dealing with the census is privileged by the Constitution, because the Constitution provides for the taking of the census. Well, the Constitution also provides that the House shall make its own rules. You have sauced the goose, sir. Can you leave the gander dry?
Will the gentleman approach the rostrum?
Got it, George. Underwood says the Democrats will support you.
Will you consent to an adjournment now? We can work something out. What do you want?
I want you to rule.
Then?
If you rule my resolution in order, the House will pass it. If you rule it out of order, I propose to appeal from that ruling. I have the vote, sir.
Your gang, eh?
And the Democrats, sir. Whichever way you rule.
If and when I rule.
You must rule. I have a right to a ruling and a right to a vote.
You can't vote on overturning my ruling until I make it, can you? And I'm entitled to permit debate on a point of parliamentary law.
Reasonable debate?
I'm the judge of what's reasonable. I'm the speaker, Mr. Norris. I'm not about to be told what I must do and when I must do it, least of all by one congressman out of the canebrake.
Sooner or later, sir...
I'll rule. That's right. But I'll decide which it is to be, sooner or later. When I decide, you'll get the ruling and the vote. When I decide. And not one blasted minute before. Chair will entertain debate on the point of order. Gentleman from New York is recognized.
Precedents dealing with privileged motions go back in the history of parliamentary law to the days of the Romans. However, as recently as in the reign of King James,
it is argued that this resolution is privileged by the Constitution. Why, Mr. Speaker, every right and privilege of this House derives from that document. To permit this motion to lie is to permit anarchy and chaos in this House.
The gentleman from Pennsylvania.
No state shall enter into any treaty, alliance, or confederation, grant letters of marque and reprisal, coin money, emit bills of credit, make anything but gold and silver coin a tender in payment of debts, pass any bill of attainder, ex post facto law, or law impairing the obligations of contracts.
Congressman Richard H. Nelson.
Aye.
Mr. Young.
Aye.
On the resolution, the ayes 191, nay 156.
Gentlemen, I ask your leave to address you now.
Mr. Speaker, I move that the House do now adjourn.
One moment, please. On a point of personal privilege. I have often said that my powers as Speaker derive solely from the support of the majority of this House. I have said that without that support, I can no longer continue as Speaker. It is apparent that the actual majority is no longer in harmony with my tenure as Speaker. Accordingly, I wish to submit my resignation.
Incredible, absolutely incredible.
I move it be accepted.
Yes.
Here, no,
here,
no.
Here.
Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker. My resolution was not intended to rebuke you or any other man. Its passage removes, not from you, but from the office of Speaker, certain tyrannical powers which no man ought to exercise over a freely elected parliament.
My motion is to accept.
Right.
Yes.
I had already moved to adjourn. I make the point of order that while my motion is before the House, no other motion will lie.
The gentleman's point of order is well taken.
Mr. Speaker.
A motion to adjourn is not debatable. On the motion, as many as are in favor.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Many as are opposed.
Aye.
And the House stands adjourned.
Goodbye, Senator Norris. Senator Groner?
I like the sound of that.
Frankly, so do I. You know, Senator Lindbergh would sound pretty good, too.
That'll never happen.
Well, I didn't think it would happen to me, either. George, Osley.
Started to paint your name over on your door. They've taken my name off my door.
Yes, I noticed.
In your case, it's because you're moving over to the Senate. In my case, it's because the people, in their wisdom, have seen fit to retire me to private life.
I know.
I notice you don't say I'm sorry. I admire that in you.
It's not personal.
Of course not. You disagree with almost everything I believe. I'm out and you're moving over to the Senate. Now, let me tell you something.
Mr. Cannon.
There's something I want to say. If any of your gang had to be elected to the Senate, I'm glad it was you.
That's kind of you.
Not at all. It's the truth. I'm sorry.
What is
it? I was just thinking. The vice president presides over the Senate.
I know.
They say the vice president's an easy job. He has my sympathy. Good luck, Senator.
Here at this hour in the morning just to denounce the armed ships bill?
No, you're not the only one. Lane and LaFalle will be here any minute.
Is the bill all that bad? What's involved?
What is involved? War is involved. The right of people to decide their future is involved. The integrity of the Senate is involved.
Oh, George, all that?
Well, Wilson already has the power to arm the ships if he wishes.
Then?
But by asking Congress to authorize him to do it, he shifts the responsibility onto the Congress.
Well, isn't that a technicality?
Well, perhaps. But I believe that responsibility should be left where the Constitution puts it.
Well, I agree.
Oh, look, if we arm those ships, the Germans are going to start shooting. And being armed, we're going to shoot back. Now, doesn't that mean war?
Yes, undeclared.
Well, it'll be declared the minute the shooting begins. Well, this is just an indirect declaration of war.
Now, I'm against war, but if we have to have it, should we slide into it, back into it, drift into it? Or should we enter it in a straightforward way with our eyes wide open?
Well, certainly, but it hardly seems the time
to be... Last November, the people re-elected Wilson. And some of his supporters used the slogan, he kept us out of war. A new Congress was also elected, and that Congress takes office 3 days from now. Now, is it right that an important decision like this be decided before they take office by a lame duck Congress? So that the new Congress has got nothing better to do than to declare the war made inevitable by the final acts of the old one?
No, it's not right. But it can't be stopped. The bill passed the House overwhelmingly. When the Senate votes, it'll be a mere...
If the Senate ever votes.
Filibuster.
Well, I prefer the term extended debate.
Oh, George, with only 3 days, won't it?
This is March 1st. Constitutionally, our term cannot extend beyond March 4th. Now, it wasn't our decision to wait until only 3 days remain before putting that bill in. And it is our obligation to debate that bill in full. And if we haven't finished by the 4th, noon of the 4th, the president will have to submit it to a new Congress.
And they will pass it.
Of course they will.
Brand us as filibusters, obstructionists, pro-German?
At least. Do you think I can convince La Follette and Lane?
You convinced me, didn't you?
There might be another 7 or 8 you can convince.
12 senators against 86.
12 against 100 million. The great war that is now in progress. We are a neutral nation. And this resolution proposes that the Congress concur in the ending of that neutrality. For to send munitions to one side is to incite attack by the other. And to arm such ships is to guarantee that these inevitable attacks will bring us into the war. Now, if you want to make war, propose it honestly and straightforwardly. And we'll debate it and abide by the result of that debate. But we will not permit our country to enter into war by subterfuge, by indirection, without ever voting directly on the issue of peace or war.
To ship munitions to one side is to incite attack by the other.
For 3 days and 3 nights, 12 senators held the Senate at bay. We were denounced by our fellow senators and vilified by the press. My mail for my constituents was evenly divided. 50% abusive, 50% threatening. Those final minutes live in my memory. The words that filled them were without meaning. Frustrated by our successful filibuster, our opposition demanded to speak. Their intention was not so much to present their view as it was to stop La Follette from expressing his. La Follette, his face contorted in anger, writhed in the humiliation of being unable to get the floor. Not far away was Harry Lane of Oregon, even then in the early stages of his mortal illness. The hour hand dragged toward 12.
This legislation will become law. Though not, it would appear, at this Congress. The United States will survive, but it has been disgraced. I regret that the senator from Wisconsin has left no time for himself. 12 men have defeated the will of this Senate through this reprehensible filibuster. Now, Mr. President, I've been using some strong language, and possibly I ought to apologize.
No, not at all. It's perfectly safe. No one has a right to reply.
Apologize to the senators who've always been so kind and considerate to me. And I assure the senator that I do not cherish any personal feeling of any kind in any way.
It is now noon, and it is my constitutional duty to announce that this Congress is ended, and that the Senate stands adjourned. Sine die.
Congratulations, George. It's all over.
Thanks, Bob. I don't think it's over. It's just begun. And then the president calls us a small group of stubborn, willful men representing no opinion but their own, who have rendered the government of the United States powerless and contemptible. He's got quite a flair for the language.
That's an outrageous statement.
Is it?
Of course it is. He armed those ships under his own authority. He didn't need the resolution.
Oh, we were right about that.
Well, then?
Well, we are a small group. We are stubborn and willful.
Well, aren't we supposed to be flighty and pliable?
Is it true that we represent no opinion but our own?
Well, that's what we were sent here for. To vote our opinions. Ours. No one else's.
But what if the people disagree with us?
They can vote us out when our term is up.
Suppose it's more than disagreement. Suppose they suspect our motives. Suppose they think of us as traitors.
The people can think what they like. The senator has the right to go on speaking his own mind until his term is up.
Does he?
Of course he does. You know that.
Well, I know that he has the power to remain and do as he thinks, just as Joe Cannon had the power to appoint committees. But he used that power unreasonably, in a way that no man has a right to use it, and so he lost it.
You're not making sense, George.
Maybe I'm just tired.
We're all tired.
We all need sleep. Osley, are you coming?
I'm gonna have some more coffee.
Good night, then.
Osley, you know what they're calling me in Nebraska?
Just talk.
A traitor. They're comparing me with Benedict Arnold, Burr.
Political talk.
No. No, you can call a man a fool, a radical. You can say he's a reactionary, stupid, tool of the interest, unscrupulous. That's political talk. Traitor is something else.
Well, you've got to live with it.
I try to look at it from the voter's standpoint. He's got a senator he disagrees with. Oh, that's all right. But what if he thinks the United States senator is a traitor in the pay of a foreign power?
If anyone thinks that of you...
Some people do if they believe what they read in the papers.
Well, what makes you think they do?
Is there any way I can know they don't?
No.
Yes, there is.
I've written a letter to the governor of Nebraska, asking him to put the question of my continuance as a senator up before a special election. And if the people don't want me, I'll resign.
You can't do that, George. Wilson's going to call a special session in 6 weeks. We need you there.
I'm not needed if I can't convince the people of Nebraska.
That you're right?
That I'm honest, that I'm not a traitor.
But you can't ask them to decide now. Not with the president calling you an obstructionist. With your own party against you, the whole country preparing for war.
Well, there'll be a campaign. I'll talk to them.
But they won't listen. Not now. You can't make them listen.
I can try.
Won't you sleep on it, George? Please, think it over.
Company. Thank you, young man.
Thank you, sir.
Sam, you go on down to the hall. I'll see you after the speech, if I survive, eh? Ladies and gentlemen, you see before you a willful man. And my willfulness is this, that I would not swallow whole without debate a measure of the utmost importance to this country. And for this refusal, I and 11 others have been denounced as traitors to our country. Now, I can stand up and take my medicine under any charge except that of traitor. For in all the English language, you can't find any other word as damnable as that. They haven't been contented with denouncing us in our own states. They held a mass meeting in New York to denounce us and to shout, "Hang him, kill him." And the New York papers called it a wonderfully patriotic audience. But there were no men in uniform there. No. The men wore dinner jackets. And the women were in evening dresses. And I couldn't help wondering how many of them were ready to send their own sons to war. But I'll tell you one thing. If poodle dogs could have been made into soldiers, that audience would have supplied a regiment. I have condemned, and I will continue to condemn,
Any system that permits any ruler anywhere to plunge his people into war, or if the President of the United States had the power to force Congress to act, his despotism would put that of the Tsar of Russia and the Kaiser of Germany to shame. And that is why I have come home, to tell you the truth.
William Norris appeared before many groups throughout Nebraska to overwhelming approval. The governor announced he would not ask for a special recall election. George Norris never changed. For another quarter of a century, he represented his state in the Senate, speaking his mind without regard for politics. Though a Protestant, a Republican, and a dry, he dared to support Al Smith in 1928, who was a Democrat, Catholic, and a wet. He survived the storm only to outrage his party again by his support of New Deal legislation in the 30s. A key structure in the TVA complex bears his name as a tribute to his fight to bring the benefits of low-cost electricity to the people of the Tennessee Valley. The senator once said, "This is my epitaph."
Stories of past courage can teach, they can offer hope, and they can provide inspiration. But they cannot supply courage itself. For this, each man must look into his own soul.